Today, I'm going to wrap up everything I've been trying to tell you guys about, you know, the counting of the Omer, you know, and how it all points to Pentecost, and trying to show that Pentecost, I think, is at the actual day the Lord is trying to show us and tell us that He's going to return on. We're really going to open it up in a big way today to really just get really pinpoint accurate to where you can, you know, almost look at it and say, man, without a shadow of a doubt, this is when the Lord's coming. You know, it's like, wow. Now, we'll tell you this. When the Lord, when He does return, there's some things toward the end, right before He returns, that's going to change a lot of things. So we won't be able to recognize. One of the things it says that, you know, the times and seasons will change, you know, that we're dealing with. A third part of the day is going to be, you know, we're only going to have a third part of the day. Because if not, for the elect's sake, it would burn up everything. So to be able to say, okay, I know the Lord's going to return on this day, I can say I know about when He's going to return, but during the time of all of this stuff going on, I don't believe we're going to know, you know, what day we're actually living in. You understand if I'm making myself clear, as far as, because you're only going to have a third of the day, you know, do you think we're going to be running around looking for clocks, and we're probably going to be hiding and trying to get away from, you know, what's actually happening. But I think the Lord lets us know through His Word when He's actually going to come, and I believe it's going to be on Pentecost. And we're going to get into that today, which is really, that's where I've been pointing everything to and driving home this message. So you guys ready?
Yep.
We're going to do a little reading, but it's going to really be good. It's going to open your eyes up. And I tell you what, just, I'm sitting down with my wife right before we got started, and you know, we know the scriptures they talk about all the time about the second coming of the Lord. You know, Paul talks about it in Thessalonians and Corinthians, he comes as a thief in the night, and you know, and we're gonna get into that. And when I got to the end of this last scripture I was looking at, I was like blown away by what I saw. I was, only God can do something like this. So let's open it up and let's get into it and see what the Lord has to say. Y'all ready?
Yeah.
All right, I'm going to pray again. Father, in Jesus' name, Lord, You're so good. Father, I just ask, Lord, that, Lord, our eyes and our ears and our hearts, Father, would just be opened. Because, Lord, we're just excited about Your return, Lord. We're looking forward to Your return. Lord, we ask Your Spirit to move. And, Lord, just make Your Word clear to us, Father. In Jesus' name, amen, amen, and amen. A lot of you guys wasn't here Wednesday. So what I wanted to do is I want to connect some dots with you guys as far as showing you that the spring feast or the fall feast and the fall feast or the spring feast, they're one and the same. Okay? One way I can do it, just by, you know, a lot of people say that Christ fulfilled the spring feast, but He hasn't fulfilled the fall feast. And they expect the Lord's return on, you know, in the fall feast on Rosh Hashanah, Yom Kippur, and the Feast of Tabernacles. Why in a fall feast? Because the fall feast, Rosh Hashanah, it means the blowing of the shofar. And that trump is the trump they believe the Lord will return on in the fall. First thing I want to tell you is, you know, did Christ fulfill the fall feast? Most teach He hasn't. But I'm going to tell you He has. And let me tell you how He has fulfilled it. Okay? Number one, Rosh Hashanah means the chief or the head of the new year. They blew a shofar. The chief or the head of the new year. Okay? When Christ came to this earth, He split time. Everything's before and after his death, right? That began a new time for you and me, right? Okay. The other thing is that, you know, Christ was born in the fall feast, right?
Yep.
September, October. So, you know, he came, his first coming was in the fall feast, right? So he fulfilled that. Also, his ministry began in the fall feast. How do we know that? We know because when he went to John, he was baptized into Jordan. You know, that was in the fall feast when he was baptized. How do we know that? We know that because Christ died at Passover, right? His ministry was 3.5 years. So if he was 33.5 years old and he died on Passover, we would go backwards to Passover. That would be 32.5, right? We'd go back to Passover again a whole year. That'd be 31.5. We'd go back to Passover again. That would be 30.5. That would be 3 years. And if we backed up 6 months from there, it would put us in a fall when Christ came for John in the Jordan and he was baptized. Therefore, his ministry, even he began his ministry in a fall feast. There was some amazing things that happened there as well. The Holy Spirit came down in a fall feast. Remember? The Holy Spirit, like a dove, descended on his head. Wow. Right? In the fall feast. Pretty amazing. The other thing is, about it, is Christ has, he's had to have fulfilled the fall feast. How do we know that? Because, number one, remember, it was Yom Kippur, the Day of Atonement, which is in a fall feast, Rosh Hashanah, Yom Kippur. On Yom Kippur, one time a year, would the high priest enter in behind the veil, right? And he'd make atonement for the sins of the people. They say, we say, Christ fulfilled that, right? But he fulfilled that in the springtime. He made atonement. Wow. So these two feasts, he fulfilled the Day of Atonement, Rosh Hashanah, Yom Kippur. He fulfilled that. How did he fulfill it? If one time the high priest would enter in behind the veil to make atonement for the sins of himself and the people of that nation on the Day of Atonement, that is the exact same thing that Christ fulfilled when he died, offered himself, rose again, brought his blood before the temple that was in heaven.
Amen.
So he fulfilled that feast. Right?
Amen. Yeah.
So beyond the they're all looking for his return to be on that feast. But Christ has already fulfilled Rosh Hashanah. He split time. He was born then. He began his ministry then, right? Yom Kippur, he made atonement then. And the Feast of Tabernacles. What is Tabernacles? He fulfilled the Feast of Tabernacles in that the Holy Spirit came down and dwelled within him. Not only did the Holy Spirit come and dwell within him on that day, which will point you directly to Pentecost, which I'm going to show you, but also the Word became flesh and dwelt among us in the Feast of Tabernacles. Therefore, Jesus Christ fulfilled the fall feast. And that's why I tell you the fall feast and the spring feast are one and the same. They're exactly. All God did was take the seventh month and made it the first month, and the first month he made the seventh month. They're identical. One and the same. Nisan 1 is the chief or the head of the new year as well, just like Rosh Hashanah is the chief or the head of the new year. Jesus was the atonement. He was the Yom Kippur on Passover. He was the fulfillment of Yom Kippur in the Feast of Tabernacles, right? When Jesus died and rose again, right? When he arose again, what happened? The next feast, you got Rosh Hashanah, Yom Kippur, and the Feast of Tabernacles. Y'all, you guys are with me, right? When Jesus arose again on the third day, he received a new tabernacle, a new body. Therefore, he fulfilled the Feast of Tabernacles.
Amen.
Ah. that one and the same. Then he abode with his disciples for 40 days. The only thing that hasn't been fulfilled yet is his return, the second coming of the Lord, and that is going to be on the great and notable day of the Lord. There's two great and notable days of the Lord in God's Word. Number one is in the fall feast, in the Feast of Tabernacles. The last day of the Feast of Tabernacles is called that great day or that notable day. Wow. Also, it's pretty amazing that Pentecost is called the same thing, that great day, the culmination of the end of the Passover feast, the last great day, Pentecost. Why? Because they're one and the same. But God just swapped them up. Why did God swap the feast up? Because in the very beginning, before he pulled Moses and all of them out of Egypt, he had made a sacrifice. And it all pointed to, you know, in the end, someone was going to come and crush the enemy's head. Is that not right? So what God did to confuse Satan, Lucifer, was he changed the times and the seasons. What? Does that kind of sound familiar to you? He changed the times and the seasons? God did, to confuse the enemy. What does the enemy do to you and me in Daniel chapter 7? He seeks to change the times and the seasons. Oh yes, that's why you and me today doesn't follow God's reckoning of time. Our calendars start in January. God's calendar starts in the spring feast and the fall feast. He says, I'm going to mess their time up. I'm going to put it right in the middle and start January here. And we're going to keep all the Gregorian false gods, you know, the moon god, Sunday, and all of these, you know, because he seeks to change the times and the seasons so that you and I doesn't know how he operates. Why? Because he was fooled. Right? So you're just doing the same thing God did. God placed a mark on Cain's head. Right? It said, no longer shall the ground yield its food for you anymore. You shall be a fugitive and a vagabond, and wherever you go, people are going to want to kill you because God placed a mark on him. God did that to Satan's children. Cain. Read it in Jude. So what does Satan do to God's children? He causes both small and great to receive a mark in their forehead or their right hand so that they can't buy or sell. And what happens? We become fugitives running all over, and whenever they see us, they want to kill us.
That's right.
You did it to my kids, I'm going to do it to your kids.
Imitator.
He's an imitator. God changed the times and seasons, Satan changed the times and seasons. Wow. One and the same. Pretty amazing, huh?
Yes.
Watch this. Now let's get into the Word. This is good stuff. So, I want you to open your Bibles up to John chapter 7. I'm going to prove to you today, beyond the shadow of a doubt, that the spring feast is the fall feast, and the fall feast is the spring feast. I told you guys, whenever Jesus ministered, he always came in, if it's, you know, dedication of lights, he said, I'm the light of the world. If it's about the bread, the fall, you know, they ate bread in the wilderness, he came in on Passover and said, I am the bread of life. That's how he operated. He operated in the feast. You're going to find out if, when you read the Word, and if you read, you know, the book of John, when John is writing, he don't write nothing in between the spring feast and fall feast. He's going to talk about Passover, and he's going to talk about the fall feast. And in the next chapter, he's going to talk about the fall feast, and he's going to talk about Passover. He don't tell you about what happens in the middle. Nor does he tell you what happens, you know, in the wintertime, in December, in January. He don't write about those times. He writes about the springtime and the fall time and how Jesus fulfilled the spring and fulfilled the fall. That's how it's written. I'll show it to you. Prove it to you beyond the shadow of a doubt. Isn't it funny? You read in John chapter 6, check this out. You read in John chapter 6, verse 1, in verse 4, and it starts off and Passover is nigh at hand. Right? Me and my brother was just having this discussion. And Passover is nigh at hand. He talks all about how it's the bread of life. Chapter 7, the very next chapter starts off in the Feast of Tabernacles. 6 months later. 7 months later. Between two chapters. Well, what happened in the middle? He didn't talk about none of that. Watch this. Now I'm going to show you something which is absolutely, God is absolutely amazing. So, we're going to go to John chapter 7. John chapter 7, verse 37. John chapter 7, and I'm going to read if you don't have it up there. John chapter 7, verse 37. John chapter 7, and he says this. I'm going to start in John chapter 7, verse 1. Check this out. Y'all ready? He says this. After these things, Jesus walked in Galilee, for he would not walk in Jewry, because the Jews sought to kill him. I'm going to read from here. Now, the Jews' Feast of Tabernacles was at hand. Now, what I want you to do is turn the page. Go to John chapter 6, verse 4. Right? Look at this. John chapter 6, I'll read from verse 1. After these things, Jesus went over to the Sea of Galilee, which was the Sea of Tiberias. A great multitude followed him because he saw the miracles which he did on them that were diseased. And Jesus went up into the mountain, and there he sat with his disciples. And Passover, the feast of the Jews, was nigh at hand. Wow. Next page, it's 7 months past now. We're at the next feast. So, now the Jews' Feast of Tabernacles is at hand. So John's talking about the spring feast, and now the next one is the fall. Watch this. In verse 3. His brethren therefore said unto him, depart hence and go into Judea, that disciples also may see the works. Let me slow down. Let me slow way down here. Go to John chapter 7, verse 1. After these things, Jesus walked in Galilee, for he would not walk in Jewry, because the Jews sought to kill him. Okay? Now the Jews' Feast of Tabernacles was at hand. His brethren, which is his brothers, real brothers, therefore said unto him, depart hence and go into Judea, that thy disciples also may see the works that thou doest. For there is no man that doeth anything in secret, for he himself seeketh to be known openly. If thou do these things, show thyself to the world. His brothers don't believe in him yet. You understand? They want him to go do some miracles so that even his own brothers will believe him. James and Judas and James and Jude and his other brothers and sister. All right? For neither did his brethren believe in him. Then Jesus said unto them, my time is not yet come. Wow, watch this. But your time is always ready. The world cannot hate you, but me it hateth, because I testify of it. The works thereof are evil. Go ye up unto this feast. I go not up yet unto this feast, for my time is not yet full come. When he had said these words unto them, he abode still in Galilee. But when his brethren were gone up, then went he also up to this feast, not openly, but as was in secret. And you got ministers out there that say, okay, that Jesus, this is speaking of when the Lord's going to return secretly and in the fall feast and all of that. And it's a good deal. You know, they got a good thing here because it's saying plainly the Feast of Tabernacles is at hand. It's a good return. He's going to come secretly. It's a 7-day feast, right? Let's keep reading though. And there was much murmuring among the people concerning him, for some said he was a good man, others said nay, but he deceived the people. Howbeit no man spake openly unto him for fear of the Jews. I like this right here. Now about the middle of the feast, Jesus went up to the temple and taught. So he came in the middle of it. Pretty important. The 7-year period, 42 months, 3.5 years. Watch this. And the Jews marveled, saying, how knoweth this man the letters, having never been learned? He wasn't a Levite. He wasn't, raised in it. They marveled by it. Jesus answered them and said, "My doctrine is not mine, but him that sent me." Now you guys can read all of this. He goes into talking about Moses and all of this kind of stuff, and for time's sake, you know, it's still the Feast of Tabernacles. Go down to 32. Nothing's changed. You can check it out for yourself. The Pharisees heard that the people murmured such things concerning him, and the Pharisees and the chief priests sent officers to take him. Then said Jesus to them, now he's in a temple, "Yet a little while and I am with you, and then I go unto him that sent me." Wait, hold on a second. How's he going to go, "Yet in a little while I'm with you, but I'm going to go to him that sent me"? When did Jesus go to him that sent him? During Passover time. He died and rose again and went to the Father. We're in a Feast of Tabernacles. Watch this. He says, "You shall seek me, but not find me. And where I am, you cannot go." Then said the Jews among themselves, "Well, where's he going to go, that we shall not find him?" Remember, that kind of sounds like Elijah when he was taken. Remember? They asked Elisha, "Let us go look for him." Right? He was taken on Pentecost. He says, "Where will he go? We can't, shall not find him. Will he go into a dispersed among the Gentiles and teach the Gentiles? What manner of saying is this that he said, 'You shall seek me and not shall be able to find me, and where I go, you cannot come'?" Listen to this, verse 37. "In the last day," that great day. Wow, that's the Feast of Tabernacles. But it's also Pentecost. How do we know that? Check this out. "In the last day," that great day of the Feast of Tabernacles, "Jesus stood and cried, saying, 'If any man thirst, let him come unto me and drink. He that believeth on me, as the scripture hath said, out of his belly shall flow rivers of living water. But this he spake, he of the Spirit, which they that believe on him should receive, for the Holy Ghost was not yet given, because that Jesus was not yet glorified." Amen. He connected the last great day of the Feast of Tabernacles directly to Pentecost, when the Holy Spirit came down and out of them flowed rivers of living water. Wow. Now, let's back up to John 6. That proves it beyond the shadow of a doubt. Now, when is he going to return? In John chapter 6, we find out that Passover, it starts off in verse 4. "And the Passover, the feast of the Jews, was nigh." Jesus starts talking about, he's the bread of life. This is when he comes. Watch. I'm giving you some stuff that is like amazing to his coming. I'm going to connect the fall feast to the spring feast, to Passover. Check this out. I'm just going to read it to you. Where you at? Go to John chapter 6.
I'm at 6, verse 1.
John chapter 6, that's 7.
I know.
Verse 40. John chapter 6, verse 1. John chapter 6, verse 1. He says, "After these things, Jesus went over the Sea of Galilee," which is the Sea of Tiberias. I'll just let you know something. The Sea of Galilee, from one side to the other, is exactly 7 miles across. I know. I went across it. I went in a boat in it. Okay? "And a great multitude followed him, because they saw his miracles, which he had done on them that were diseased. And Jesus went up into the mountain, and there he sat with his disciples. And the Passover, a feast of the Jews, was nigh. When Jesus had lifted up his eyes and saw a great company coming to him, he saith unto Philip, 'Whence shall we buy bread that we can feed these?' And he said, to prove him, for he himself knew what he would do." Now stop right there. I want to get into Jesus now feeds the 5,000, right? Okay. He feeds the 5,000 right here. And then In verse 13, therefore they gathered together and filled 12 baskets of fragments with 5 barley loaves. And y'all know the story there. And I'm going to drop down a little bit further. And then it says, here we go. And I'm going to start reading in verse 15. When Jesus therefore perceived that they would come and take him by force to make him king. Wow. 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 What did you say?
Wow.
They want to make him king.
Right.
He becomes king when he returns. They're connecting it for us. You're ready now. When Jesus therefore perceived that they would come and take him by force to make him a king, and he departed again into the mountain himself alone. And when even was now come, his disciples went down to the sea and entered into a ship and went over the sea toward Capernaum. And it was now dark, and Jesus was not come to them. And the sea arose by reason of a great wind blew. And when they had rowed about 5 and 25 furlongs, that's 3 to 3.5 miles, right? They're in the midst of a 7-mile sea. In the middle of it.
Halfway.
Sound familiar?
Yeah.
Jesus, they rode about 5 and 25 furlongs. They saw Jesus walking on the sea. Wow, kind of funny there. And drawing nigh unto the ship, and they were afraid. When Jesus comes, they're going to be afraid, right? But he saith unto them, it is I, be not afraid, right? Then they willingly received him into the ship, and immediately, sounds like a translation, they were transported. Immediately the ship was at the land whether they went. Immediately.
Yeah.
Immediately. In a moment. In a twinkling of an eye. Shabam. They were on the other side. The day following, when the people which stood on the other side of the sea saw that there was none other boat there save the one whereunto his disciples were entered, and that Jesus went not with his disciples into the boat, but that his disciples were going away alone, howbeit there came other boats from Tiberias nigh unto the place where they did eat bread after the Lord had given thanks. When the people therefore saw that Jesus was not there, neither his disciples, they also took shipping and came to Capernaum seeking for Jesus. And when they had found him on the other side of the sea, they said unto him, Rabbi, when camest thou hither? Jesus answered and said unto them, Verily, verily, I say unto you, you seek me not because you saw the miracles, but because you did eat of the loaves and were filled. Labor not for the meat which perisheth, but for that meat which endureth unto everlasting life. Labor for it. That means work. It's a job to get in this. You heard me? Which the Son of Man shall give unto you, for him hath God the Father sealed. Then said he unto them, What shall we do that we might work the works of God? Believe on him. Jesus answered and said unto him, This is the work of God, that ye believe on him who hath sent. Then said they for unto him, What sign showest thou that we may see and believe what thou dost, the work you do? Our fathers did eat manna in the desert. Hold on. I don't want to go. In verse 39, I'm just going to drop down to 39. I want to show you. And this far, and it says in verse 39, I want to show you some things that, you know, the Lord points out right here. It's going to point to his coming. He's in the feast of Passover. And watch what he says here. I'm going to start in 38. For I came down from heaven, not to do mine own will, but the will of him that sent me. And this is the Father's will, which hath sent me, that all which he hath given me, I should lose none, but should raise it up again at the last day. Right? They end the feast of Passover. The last day is Pentecost. If you drop down, verse 44, no man can come unto me except the Father which hath sent me draw him, and I shall raise him up at the last day. And verse 54, whosoever eateth my flesh and drinketh my blood hath eternal life, and I will raise him up at the last day. They know what the last day is. Okay? Now check this out. Let's keep reading. I just wanted to establish and show you that the spring feast or the fall feast, they're one and the same. Okay. Now, we started this off by talking and showing that, you know, from, what was it, from Egypt to Mount Sinai. Remember how we started all that? You know, here, I'll just read it to you. We started. I talked to you last week about the Mount of Transfiguration and Moses and Elijah connection, showing how it was all the same thing. And here's the countdown to Mount Sinai is the countdown to the marriage. The countdown to Mount Sinai is the countdown to his coming. And it's all about Pentecost, when the Lord's going to come and return for us. So we're going to go to Peter holds the key. So this is where everything, here is the tie-in for you guys for everything, okay? This is where everything comes together for you. On the day of Pentecost, there's a lot of beliefs about what the day of Pentecost is and what it's symbolic to and what it means. But Peter makes it perfectly clear to you and me what Pentecost really is and what it's about. Number one, it is about the Holy Spirit coming down. And they did speak in other languages as the Spirit gave them utterance. Pentecost was about, it was written in stone with Moses. Now it's written in the hearts of people. When it was burned in their hearts, they began to speak, right? It was written in the law by fire, by the finger of God, by fire. Cloven like divided tongues came and sat on their head. And as the Spirit gave them utterance, that means burned it in their heart. The baptism of the Holy Ghost and fire. That means when it came in their heart and they began to speak, they had the understanding and the revelation of what the Old Testament meant, the Old Covenant. That's what happened. And they began to prophesy. What does that mean? They began to connect the dots of the Old Covenant and the New Covenant, that Jesus Christ was the fulfillment of what they were seeing. The Bible says that when the Holy Spirit comes, He will endue you with power and authority to preach the gospel. Who? On your sons and your daughters. It is for everyone, even your servants and your handmaids, and him and whoever, even through the end of the age, who will receive Jesus Christ, can receive the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit will bring all things to your remembrance. Things that Jesus Christ had spoken to him and taught him in that time. When you have to say something, don't worry about what you're going to say. For my Spirit, the Holy Spirit's going to renew it, bring it back to you, what it is you must say. But you must spend time with Jesus. You must spend time with Jesus. The only way you can do that is in His Word.
Amen.
If you do not spend time in His Word, the Holy Spirit will bring nothing to your remembrance. You will have no power, no authority, and you'll be made a laughing stock. And your tail will get ducked between your legs as you walk off down the street because you have not studied to show yourself approved unto God. A workman who needeth not to duck his tail between his legs and be ashamed. To rightly, correctly handle the Word of God.
Amen.
That's what it was made for. That's what that is for. So, no quiet. Oh, come on.
Will you say it? Tell me again.
Come on.
About when they said when they spoke in tongues?
When they spoke in tongues, there was many, and we're going into that.
Right.
We're going to go into, there was many different languages and people that was there.
Right.
And you're going to see when we read Acts chapter 2, as the Spirit came down and rested upon them on Pentecost, and it went, the Holy Spirit, you know, wrote it in their heart. Right. At that moment right there, after being with Jesus for 3.5 years, all of a sudden, it clicked. Oh my God. Like Peter. Men and brethren, these men ain't drunk as ye suppose. This is what Joel said. This is what David said. This is what the prophet said. The light came on. So right at that moment, they got the interpretation and the understanding of the Word of God.
Right.
And right there, they received power and authority. Power and authority comes from you knowing your Word. That's power and authority.
Amen.
That's the sword of the Spirit, is to know the Word of God. When you know the Word of God, then look, no devil in hell can mess with you. Because you have power and authority. Hey, I know what this is all about. I've been given power and authority to tread on you. Get out my way in Jesus' name. And if he still aren't moving, you can put a lashing on him with the Word.
Amen.
But you got to know the Word to put a lashing on him with the Word.
Right.
First. Right?
Yes.
Right.
All
okay.
The languages said it was for all the world.
And all the languages was for all the world. They were hearing the gospel, the good news preached in their own tongue. Now watch this. This is where it gets good. Peter holds the key to what happens on the day of Pentecost. But not only does he hold the key to what happened on Pentecost, of what was happening at that moment, but actually He tells us when Jesus is coming. Wow. Let's look at it. Y'all ready?
Yeah.
Go to Acts chapter 2.
Acts what?
Acts chapter 2. Now it gets fun. I'm going to show you guys some stuff. Wow. Wow, 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 wow. And you can leave it in Acts, Zach, when you get up there in Acts chapter 2. You guys in your Bibles, let me read. You guys look at Acts chapter 1.
Is it right here?
Acts chapter 2. Yeah, stay right there. You guys look at your Bible. Let's look at this real quick. Acts chapter 1 verse 1. I'm going to read just a few verses down. He says, The former book have I made, O Theophilus, of all Jesus began to both to do and to teach. This is Luke. Luke wrote the book of Luke and he wrote Acts. If you want to read it in order, go read Luke and then come over to Acts. Okay? Watch this. Until the day in which he was taken up, after that he, through the Holy Ghost, given commandment unto the apostles whom he had chosen. Right? To whom also he showed himself alive after his passion by many infallible proofs, being seen of them 40 days and speaking of things pertaining to the kingdom of God, and being assembled together with them, commanded them that they should not depart from Jerusalem, but wait for the promise of the Father, which saith he that he hath heard from me. So they knew Pentecost was only 10 days away. You know that, right?
Yeah.
He showed it. He was with them for 40 days. The 50th day is Pentecost. He said, don't go nowhere. Don't leave. Stay here. Don't leave Jerusalem. In fact, it was mandatory that they appear before God on Passover, Pentecost, and Tabernacles. Don't leave. Because you're going to be endued with power on Pentecost. And 380 of them left. Watch this. For John truly baptized with water, but you shall be immersed, cleansed, cleaned with the Holy Ghost on the inside, not many days from here. Right? So he can come and live inside of him. When they therefore were come together, they asked him, saying, Lord, watch this. Here's another key. Lord, wilt thou at this time restore again the kingdom of Israel? The kingdom to Israel? When is the kingdom restored to Israel? When he returns.
Right.
There's another key. He's telling them, wait, they're giving it to you. But he says, look, I mean, it's 2,000 years from that day. So he tells them, and he said unto them, it is not for you to know the times and the seasons which the Father has put in his own power. Do you think it was important for them to know the times and the seasons? He wasn't going to return for 2,000 years. Yeah. What if he said, hey, no, brother, look, it's not going to happen. The kingdom is not going to be restored for another 2,000 years. They'd be like, what? What the heck am I here for?
Right.
Do you see? Look, if he's got to keep them alert and aware, always looking. If he'd have said, no, I'm not coming back for another 2,000 years, they'd have quit looking. That's why he told old Daniel, seal up the book for the time of the end, for much time has to pass. Right?
Right.
He didn't want to turn their hearts away.
Right.
He wanted them prepared and ready every day looking for his return.
Right.
Somebody tells me, no, I'm going to go and then I'm going to come back in 2,000 years. 2,000, what? I'm going fishing. Right? I'm going fishing. He ain't coming back for 2,000 years? Oh, man. Give me a break. How far you think the gospel would have went from there? How can you go anywhere and say, you know, man, Jesus is coming back. You need to be ready, be prepared in 2,000 years. Okay. See you later. I mean, I can see the multitudes leaving. There ain't nobody there. But maybe the dog. That's true. You got to think about what. Put yourself there. Check this out. This is good, huh?
Yeah.
It's good stuff. I love the word. And he said unto them, it is not for you to know the times and the seasons, but it is for us.
Yeah.
Watch. Which the Father has put in his own power, but what's more important for you is, but you shall receive power after that the Holy Ghost is come upon you, and ye shall be witnesses unto me both in Jerusalem and Judea and Samaria and to the uttermost parts of the earth.
Amen.
That's more important than anything. To be a witness for him, to be endued with power. He shall not only come upon you, but he shall come in you and make his abode inside of you. But first you need to be washed clean.
Right.
He cleanses your inside so your temple now can become inhabitable by his presence, by his Holy Spirit, so that when you're reading the word, the Spirit of God lives in you, he can begin to reveal it to you and show you his word. But first you have to read it. First you have to read it. You have to get it in you.
That's right. Right.
And the Bible says, don't labor after the steaks at Ryan's, but labor after the meat of his word.
Amen. Right. Hallelujah.
Which will give you life everlasting.
Amen. Yeah.
I love them steaks at Ryan's. And these steaks too. Now that that's settled, let's go to Acts chapter 2. Because what happens? The empowerment of the Holy Spirit now is going to be manifested. What does the empowerment of the Holy Spirit do? It does the same thing we just read in John chapter 7. How does this man speak with power and authority, not having learned the scriptures?
Levi.
How? Because he said, and little did they know, he was the Word.
Right.
He was the Word. He had received. Jesus could do no miracles until the age of 30. None. Zero. Zero. None. Not uno. Not dos o tres. not none. How do I know that? Because he was not yet empowered by the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Until he began his ministry.
It's also the time to set for them to become a priest.
That's exactly right.
They couldn't become a priest.
They couldn't become a priest till the age of 30. That means he couldn't go into service under the authority of God that was given to him to begin his ministry until he received the power of the Holy Spirit. There are books that are out there right now, the miracles of Jesus when he was a child. They said he raised a dead bird. A building was falling over and he put his hand on it, it straightened backed up. Bologna sausage! Bologna! Bologna! Limburger cheese. That stinks.
Yes.
I like bologna. Especially fried bologna. That's poor man pork chops. I ate that when I was a kid. Mama, get pork chops, we got some fried bologna. That'll work. Right. Y'all with me? Let's find out really what the word of God means. I mean, really. We want to know the truth here.
Yes.
I don't want to, you know, I want power and authority to be able to interpret the word.
Yes.
That sets people free. That's in bondage. Right? Now, let's see. Acts chapter 2. And when the day of Pentecost, the day of Pentecost. That's the last great day, the culmination. We're going to see that. He's going to say it point blank, which I like. And when that day of Pentecost was fully come, they were all with one accord in one place. And suddenly there came a sound from heaven, as of a rushing mighty wind. That word is ruach. That's the Holy Spirit. And filled the whole house where they were sitting. Wow. See what the Spirit does? He fills a house. The Spirit of God is looking for a house to get in. It filled the physical house up there. It just filled that house. But ain't nothing yet happened. So having a Spirit in this house, flowing around up in here, moving around, ain't nothing gonna happen. But once he gets inside of you, son, and he burns that fire in you, then all of a sudden, the tongues start rolling. What tongue? This tongue. You start prophesying. You start speaking about Jesus Christ. All you want to do is talk about him and what he's done. And you start showing him. Like Paul said, I only preach Jesus Christ and him crucified. Right? It says, and there appeared unto them cloven like tongues of fire. And it sat on each one of them. And they were all filled with the Holy Ghost and began to speak with other tongues as the Spirit gave them utterance. It goes on to tell you all the people that were gathered up, strangers in Rome and Cappadocia and Galatia, and all of these people, okay? If you want to, Peter, it would keep going. All right. Now, verse 14, where I wanted to get. Peter explains Pentecost. Oh. Let's get the explanation of this. Y'all ready?
Yeah.
Peter, standing up with the 11, lifted up his voice and said unto them, ye men of Judah, and all ye that dwell at Jerusalem, be this known unto you, and hearken to my words. For these are not drunken, as ye suppose, seeing it's about 9 o'clock in the morning. But this is the power of the Holy Spirit is going to give you the interpretation of what the scriptures mean. So the first thing that Peter does is he goes back. Take notice, Peter is an unlearned man. The Holy Spirit comes upon him, and all of a sudden, he starts explaining what the scriptures mean.
Right.
He's been on a boat his whole life.
Yeah.
Wrapped with a linen cloth,
yeah.
Dark and hairy, really scary looking guy. Yeah. Don't want to mess with him. He's a beast. I guarantee it. Pull nets your whole life. Peter put his hands on you, you're in trouble.
Yeah.
Ain't no. Why do you think Peter pulled a sword out when the whole garrison army come in there?
Yeah.
He was ready.
Yeah.
Let's get him. He ain't no coward, but this time he pulls out a different sword. Wow. First one to pull the sword again. Yeah. Old Peter pulled the sword twice. Pulled out the physical sword. Oh, this time, pulled out the spiritual sword, the word of his mouth, the sword of the Spirit. He says, but Peter standing up, be this known unto you, and hearkening to my words, that these men are not drunken, seeing it's nine. But this is that what was prophesied by the prophet Joel. This is what I want you to grab more than anything. Listen to this. And it shall come to pass in the last days, saith God, I will pour out my spirit upon all flesh, and your sons and your daughters will prophesy. And your men, young men, shall see vision, and your old men will dream dreams. And on my servants and on my handmaidens, I will pour out my spirit, and they shall prophesy. I'm going to ask you a question. Did Peter stop right there?
No.
He did not stop. I'm going to show you an instance of a stop. He didn't stop. Why? Let's keep reading. And I will show wonders in heaven above and signs in the earth beneath, blood and fire and vapors of smoke. And the sun shall be turned into darkness and the moon into blood before the great and notable day the Lord come. And it shall come to pass that whosoever shall call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved.
Amen.
Listen to me. Peter is saying, he didn't stop up at the top, your sons and daughters would prophesy. He identified Pentecost with the outpouring of the Holy Spirit, number one, but also Pentecost with the return of the Lord. He said, this is the day. This is what the prophet Joel said. Well, what did Joel say? Huh. Well, I'm glad you asked. Let's go see what Joel talks about. He is confirming that this is the day that Joel spoke about. Let's go look and see what Joel said. Joel. It's amazing how just something right in front of our face is so plain and simple. Joel chapter 2. You remember when the Lord came down on Pentecost? There was the great sound, there was the voice and the trunk. Remember all of that happened on Pentecost when God came down on Pentecost? And there was fire and smoke and all this stuff. Let's look at Joel chapter 2. Blow ye the trumpet in Zion! Sound the alarm in my holy mountain! Oh my Lord, son! If that's not Pentecost, I don't know what is. Where did the trumpet first blow? In God's holy mountain. Right? Let all the inhabitants of the land tremble, for the day of the Lord cometh. Now Peter said that Pentecost, this is what Joel prophesied. Are you with me?
Yeah.
Y'all understand what I'm saying? You understand, right? Here's the day. It's Pentecost. And he's saying, this is the day. What? For it is nigh at hand. Let's go. A day of darkness and gloomness. A day of clouds and thick darkness. As the morning spread upon the mountains. A great people and strong. There hath not been ever like it. Wow, darkness and mourning and clouds and gloomness and thick darkness. That's Pentecost when God came down. Right. And it says, even to the years of many generations. A fire devoureth before them. Fire came down. And behind them a flame burneth. The land is like the garden of Eden before them, and behind them desolate wilderness. Yea, and nothing shall escape them. The appearance of them is like the appearance of horses, and as the horsemen, so shall they run. Like the noise of chariots on the tops of mountains shall they leap, like the noise of the flame of fire that devoureth the stubble, as a strong people set in battle array. This is Jesus coming. Come on. Before their face the people shall be much pained. All the faces shall gather blackness. They shall run like mighty men. They shall climb the wall like men of war. And they shall march every one his ways, and they shall not break their ranks. Neither shall one thrust another. They shall walk every one in his path. And when they fall upon the sword, they shall not be wounded. That's you and me, people. You understand that? This is the Lord's army. They shall run to and fro in the city. They shall run upon a wall. They shall climb up upon the houses. They shall enter in at the windows like a thief. A thief. Does that make sense to you?
Yes.
Didn't that Paul say that in Corinthians and in Thessalonians? Behold, the Lord cometh like a thief. Wow. Pentecost. He comes like a thief to those who don't know him. This is amazing stuff. The earth shall quake before them. The heavens shall tremble. The sun and the moon shall be turned dark. Wow. And the stars shall withdraw from shining. And the Lord shall utter his voice before his army, for his camp is very great. For he is strong that executeth his word. For the day of the Lord is great and very terrible, and who can abide in it? Therefore also now, saith the Lord, turn ye even to me with all your heart, and with fasting, and with weeping, and with mourning. And rend your heart and not your garments. And turn unto the Lord your God, for he is gracious and merciful, slow to anger and great kindness, and repenteth him of the evil. Who knoweth if he will return and repent, and leave a blessing behind him, even a meat offering and a drink offering unto the Lord your God. Blow ye the trumpet in Zion, sanctify a fast, call a solemn assembly. Gather the people, sanctify the congregation, it's marriage time. Assemble the elders, gather the children and those that suck. Oh, woe unto them that give suck in those days. And let the bridegroom go forth out of his chambers, and the bride out of her closet. And Peter, by the Holy Spirit, said, this is that day, Pentecost. Let the priest, the ministers of the Lord, weep between the porch and the altar, and let them say, spare thy people, O Lord, and give not thy heritage to reproach, that the heathen should rule over them. Wherefore should they say among the people, where is their God? Then will the Lord be jealous for his land and pity his people. Yea, the Lord will answer and say unto his people, behold, I will send you corn and wine and oil, and you shall be satisfied therewith. And I will no more make you a reproach among the heathen. But I will remove far off from you the northern army, and I will drive him into the land barren and desolate, with his face toward the east sea, and his hinder parts toward the uttermost sea. And his stink shall come up, and his ill savor shall come up, because he hath done great things. Fear not, O land, be glad, rejoice, for the Lord will do great things. Be not afraid, ye beasts of the field, for the pastures of the wilderness do spring forth. The tree beareth her fruit, and the fig tree and the vine do yield their strength. Be glad then, ye children of Zion, and rejoice in the Lord your God, for he hath given you the former rain. Hosea 6, moderately, and he will cause to come down for you the rain, the former rain and the latter rain in the first month. That's Nisan, that's Passover, that's the spring feast. and the floors shall be full of wheat. Wow, that's Ruth. And the vats and the floors shall be full of wheat. That's Pentecost. Barley is before it. Remember?
Right.
And the vats shall overflow with wine and oil. And I will restore to you the years the locusts have eaten, and the cankerworm, and the caterpillar, and the palmer worm, my great army which I set among you. And ye shall eat plenty and be satisfied, and praise the name of the Lord your God, and he that dwelt wondrously with you, and my people shall never be ashamed. And ye shall know that I am in the midst of Israel. I am there. Wow. And that I am the Lord your God and none else, and my people shall never be ashamed. And it shall come to pass, said Peter, by the Holy Spirit, afterward, that I will pour out my Spirit upon all flesh, and your sons and your daughters shall prophesy, and your old men will dream dreams, and your young men will see visions. And also upon thy servants and upon thy handmaids, in those days I'll pour out my Spirit, as Pentecost, and I will show wonders in heaven and the earth, and blood and fire and pillars of smoke. That's what's coming. The sun shall be turned to darkness and the moon into blood before the great and terrible day the Lord come. And it shall come to pass that whosoever shall call upon the name of the Lord shall be delivered. For in the Mount Zion and in Jerusalem shall be deliverance, as the Lord had said, and in the remnant whom the Lord shall call. Let's go. Chapter 32. And it shall come to pass that whosoever...
I read that. That's it.
That's it? Go to 3. You gotta know. For behold, in those days and in that time, when I shall bring again the captivity of Judah and Jerusalem, I will also gather all nations, and I will bring them down into the valley of Jehoshaphat. That's, you know, that is the valley of judgment. That's the valley of Megiddo. That's the end when he's coming. And I will plead with them there for my people and for my heritage Israel, whom they have scattered among the nations and parted my land. And they have cast lots for my people. You see why? You know, they all with this agreement over there in Israel with parting the land. You don't part the land. God's going to deal with them.
Amen. That's right.
Anyway, I'm going to stop right there. I want to read a couple of more to you guys. Peter gives us the key in Acts chapter 2.
Do I keep doing this?
You could just stop. Here's the key. Acts chapter 2. The sun's darkened and the moon turns to blood before the great and notable day the Lord comes. Now it says that in Revelations. Says that in Matthew chapter 24. Says that in Joel. Right? It's pretty amazing. The Bible talks about how when the day of the Lord, when he returns, on that day, or that notable day, or the last day. It's all Pentecost. It's all that day. Let's look at, I want to read to you as a side note, Numbers chapter 11, verse 25. Numbers 11. Show you some amazing things. Amazing. 11:25. It says, and the Lord came down, in a cloud. When is that?
Pentecost,
that's right. And spake unto him, and took the Spirit that was upon him, and gave it unto the 70 elders. And it came to pass that when the Spirit rested upon them, they prophesied and did not cease. When was that? That was Pentecost. He does it every time. That's Numbers 11, chapter 11, verse 25. He is like absolutely amazing. God is amazing. Okay, I'm going to skip some. You guys are got it. I want to show you some pretty interesting connections, though, and then we're going to be done. I'm just about finished. So Peter interprets what Joel chapter 2 is. It's on Pentecost. I want to get to some pretty notable things that you guys know. Go to Zechariah chapter 14. Zechariah chapter 14, because this is, right, the Lord. In Zechariah chapter 14, this is when the Lord returns. This is all about the return of the Lord in Zechariah 14. And check this out. Zechariah chapter 14. He says this. I love this. Behold, chapter 14, verse 1. Behold, the day of the Lord cometh. Wow. Boy, does that make a click for you guys now? I guarantee it, when you see the day of the Lord cometh, it's instantly going to go, it's Pentecost, right? Watch this. Remember about the rivers and all that stuff healing and running and flowing? Behold, the day of the Lord cometh, and the spoil shall be divided in the midst of thee. For I will gather all the nations against Jerusalem to battle. Didn't we just read that in Joel?
Yeah.
It's the same day. It's Pentecost. Watch. And the city shall be taken, and the house raffled, and the women ravished, and half of the city shall go forth into captivity, and the residue of the people shall not be cut off. Then shall the Lord go forth and fight against those nations, as when he fought in the day of battle. And his feet shall stand in that day. And his feet shall stand in that day. What day? On a Mount of Olives. Check this out. And his feet shall stand in that day upon the Mount of Olives. Where was Jesus when he told his disciples, go wait and tarry till they be endued with power? On the Mount of Olives, right? Amen. Why do you stand here gazing, looking up into the heaven? The same Jesus in like manner that went up in clouds will return. You see what I'm saying? Ooh, he is amazing. It says, and his feet shall stand in that day. What day? Upon the Mount of Olives, which is before Jerusalem on the east. And the Mount of Olives shall cleave in the midst thereof toward the east and toward the west. And there shall be a very great valley. And half of the mountain shall remove toward the north and the other half toward the south. And ye shall flee to the valley of the mountains, through the valley of the mountains, that shall reach unto Azazel. Yea, you shall flee like as you fled before the earthquake in the days of Uzziah, the king of Judah, and the Lord my God, and the Lord my God shall come, and all his saints with thee. Wow. When the Lord comes, he comes with all his saints. Wow. Does that make sense? Just check this stuff out, man. Where is Paul getting his information from when he says, when the Lord returns, he comes with all his saints? You think it was just you know, downloaded? You think, oh, God just spoken? When Paul talks about in 1 Thessalonians and 1 Corinthians that the great notable day when the Lord comes and all of this stuff, where is he getting it from? That the dead in Christ are going to rise first. Where did he get it from? I'm glad you asked. Let's see. No, he got it from the Word.
Yes.
He's quoting. Right. He's quoting Scripture. Right. He's quoting Zechariah. Right. Let's see. What about the dead in Christ? When are they going to raise? Well, I'm glad you asked. Let's see. Go to Isaiah 26. Isaiah 26. Yes. Love this Scripture. Isaiah 26, and I'm be done. Wow, you know, I like when Jesus said in Matthew chapter 24, when the Lord comes, it's like a woman in travail about to give birth, right? Also in 1 Thessalonians chapter 5, around verse 3, like a woman going into travail when the Son of Man's going to come. When is that? You see, Pentecost has a date that's set. A woman has a period that they carry a child, 266 days, right? They have a day.
Right.
Right? Like a woman in travail. You start seeing the signs. Look at verse 17. Isaiah 26, 17. It's talking about the Lord and his coming. Y'all with me?
Yeah.
You ready? Mm-hmm. Like as a woman with child that draweth near, the time of her delivery is in pain and crieth out in her pangs. So have we been in thy sight, O Lord. We have been with child. We have been in pain. We have as it were brought forth wind. What you said? That's the Spirit. That's the Ruach HaKodesh. That's Pentecost. Watch this. We have not wrought any deliverance in the earth, neither have the inhabitants of the world fallen. Thy dead men shall live together with my dead body. They shall arise. Awake and sing, ye that dwell in the dust. For thy dew is the dew of herbs, and the earth shall cast out its dead. Come, my people, and enter thou into the chambers. Wow, watch this. And shut thy doors about thee. Hide thyself, as it were, for a little moment until the indignation, the great tribulation, the last 3.5 years are overpassed. For behold, the Lord cometh out of his place to punish the inhabitants of the earth. Who else is he punished? The devil, right? When he comes. Let's see if that's what it says here. For the earth all shall disclose her blood, and shall no more cover her slain. In that day, 27, in that day, the Lord with his sore and great and strong sword shall punish Leviathan, that piercing serpent, even Leviathan, that crooked serpent. He shall slay the dragon that is in the sea. Sound like Revelations to me? Wow. Here, I'm going to show you one more thing. Go to 1 Corinthians chapter 15. 1 Corinthians chapter 15. My last scripture. And I'm going to leave you with this. Leave you with this. Because this is wow. Okay. Y'all ready?
Yeah.
1 Corinthians 15. And 1 Corinthians chapter 15, this scripture is so familiar and so read. Everybody knows it. Paul's talking about corruptible and incorruptible, the dead body, celestial bodies raised from the dead. And we get down to verse 51. I'm going to skip all the way to 51. You okay?
I'm fighting.
All right.
My medicine.
Look what Paul says. Behold, I show you a mystery. Paul's writing a letter. He's writing a letter right now, okay? To the Corinthian church about the coming of the Lord. Right? He deals with a few things in the beginning of the letter. He ends the letter with his coming. Why? Let's see. Behold, I show you a mystery. We shall not all sleep, but we shall be changed in a moment, in the twinkling of an eye, at the last trump. The trumpet shall sound, and the dead shall be raised, and we shall be changed. He's quoting from Isaiah chapter 26. He's quoting from Isaiah 26. Watch this. For this corruptible must put on incorruption, and this mortal put on immortality. So when this corruptible shall have put on incorruption, and this mortal shall have put on immortality, then shall be brought to pass the saying that is written, death is swallowed up in victory. O death, where is your sting? O grave, where is your victory? We know Christ, you know, took care of that. The sting of death is sin, and the strength of sin is the law. But thanks be to God, which giveth us victory through our Lord Jesus Christ. Therefore, my brethren, my beloved brethren, be ye steadfast and unmovable, always abounding in the work of the Lord, for as much as ye know that your labor is not in vain. Next verse. Next verse. Now concerning the collection, I told you what that was for. We went over it. It was for Jerusalem. He says it. But I'll read it. Now concerning the collection for the saints, he's summing up his letter. Last one. He says, now concerning the collection of the saints, as I've given order to the churches of Galatia, even so do ye. Upon the first day of the week, let every one of you lay in store, as God has prospered him, that there be no gathering when I come. And when I come, whosoever shall approve by your letters, them will I send to bring your liberty unto Jerusalem, because it was a great famine. Okay? And if it be meet that I go also, I shall go. The conclusion of the letter. Man, the keys are always in the conclusion sometimes. Like, wow. Check this out. Now I come unto you. Now I will come unto you when I shall pass through Macedonia. For I do pass through Macedonia. and it might be that I will abide, yea, and winter with you, that you may bring me on my journey whithersoever I go. For I will not see you now by the way, but I trust to tarry a while with you, if the Lord permit. But I will tarry at Ephesus until Pentecost. He's talking about the coming of the Lord,
yes.
And it's right at Pentecost. Are you serious? Are you serious? Are you serious?
Yeah.
Are you serious?
Yeah.
You're going to sum up a letter about the coming of the Lord Jesus. The only reason he would do it is because what he summed up fit the season he was in.
Right.
Pentecost. He wanted to go to Jerusalem. He wanted to get to Jerusalem, but he wasn't able to do it. It says he, in Ephesians, he tarried at Ephesus for Pentecost. He knows what Pentecost means. That's why he says it in Thessalonians, the same thing, the same exact thing. He's talking about the coming of the Lord, Thessalonica, and it's Pentecost. In Corinthians, it's Pentecost. So now you know what all of that boiled down to. The great notable day when the Lord comes.
Pentecost.
Most likely will be on Pentecost. But now we got to wait till, you know, until he comes. Yes.
Why do you think that it's described so differently?
What's that?
Why do you think Pentecost is described differently?
It's not described differently. It's just because you were raised in the West. We were raised in the West here. We're Americans.
When you were reading, and I think it was in Isaiah, when you were reading about the dark day and the clouds and it's so gloomy.
Well, that's what happened on Pentecost. We got to remember, the Bible says, as lightning comes from the east to the west, so shall the coming of the Son of Man be. He's going to come with clouds and great glory, and every eye will see him. The heavens are going to roll back like a scroll. It's going to be a day of great darkness. So think about this. If you tear back the veil, the blue veil, what's behind it? Black. It'd be like, you know, an alien ship coming, you know, in clouds. You know, it's got the black clouds and all that just coming. Man, that's how it's described. Like he descended on Mount Sinai. That is the coming of how it's going to be. That's why the Bible says every eye will see him when he tears the veil up there.
So what, I mean, just a beautiful day.
For us, it will.
For us?
Well, yes.
What's gonna, I'm going to tell you what's going to happen. When they see these big hands reach down, because remember, the veil in the temple was rent from the top to the bottom, which is a picture of the veil that's in heaven. That veil, God's going to take it and he's going to tear it open. Like that. And everybody's going to be like this. Look. And look, they're going to do this and turn. Like they're running from Godzilla. And look, and it's going to be us. We're going to be running to them. They're going to be running away. We're going to be running to them. And all of a sudden, we'll be running. We're just going to go up. That's going to be a glorious day, huh? Wow, they're going to be freaking out. What's the matter? Man, that's my dad. Get out of the way. Come on. Let's pray. Father, you're good, Lord. Thank you for your spirit who gives us, you know, we're children of the light, not children of the darkness, so that that day doesn't overtake us as a thief, Lord. Thank you for your spirit, Lord, and thank you that you've given us the understanding of your word, Lord. Lord, thank you, Father. Lord, because you called us and you chose us, not by something we done. We didn't have to be approved, you know, to do, to be good in order to be accepted. Your word says while we were yet sinners, you died for us. And Father, just, I want to thank you. And I know everybody here, thank you for calling us. Thank you for calling us and choosing us, Lord, to be with you, Father. That is nothing that we done. It was all you. You pursued us. Now we pursue you, Father. Thank you, Lord, in Jesus' name.